what condition our daughter was in. That was the worst night of my life.
She did not deserve this. All she wanted to do was bring love into this world.
It's been 7 months since the Danforth shooting. Today, victims and family members are speaking out, calling for action to stop another possible attack. Toronto police have completed the investigation into last summer's deadly shooting on Danforth Avenue. That news comes as friends and family members of the shooting victims gathered this morning. They are asking for private ownership of handguns and assault rifles to be banned in Canada. Talia Ritchie joins us live now from the Danforth. And Talia, this is the first time we are hearing from this group.
Dwight, it was the first time that siblings, mothers, and fathers who were impacted by the shooting spoke publicly. They want their voices to be heard when it comes to gun violence, but their biggest ask is for a ban on the private ownership of handguns and assault rifles. They're calling on the government to take more action faster, and doing so by sharing very personal stories. Time hasn't healed the loss felt by these families.
I vividly remember my parents yelling at me to call Reese. We little knew that minutes away from us, our Reese had been shot and killed. The bond me and Reese had is irreplaceable. Not only was she my sister, but she was truly my best friend.
But it has created space for courage to build.
It's really hard, and I didn't want to do it, but it's for Reese and Juliana.
10-year-old Juliana Kozis also died that day. Now, for the first time, people united by what happened on the Danforth are speaking out, delivering an open letter to Justin Trudeau asking for a Canada-wide ban on private ownership of handguns and assault rifles.
Canadians just went through an unprecedented year of gun violence, and particularly in Toronto. And, you know, we feel like gun ownership has grown in Canada. Many people don't realize to what extent.
Following the shooting, Toronto City Council called for a national ban on handguns. The Liberal government is currently exploring the possibility.
Absolutely, there should be a ban on private possession of restricted firearms like handguns and assault weapons. These restricted firearms already can only be used at ranges. There is no reason for them to be owned at home.
Claire Smith says getting the call that her daughter was shot was one of her worst nightmares come true.
Those agonizing moments of waiting to hear what condition our daughter was in, that was the worst night of my life.
Reese and I and our best friend Schieffer, like, we always talked about, like, what our kids are going to be doing together in the future. Like, when we're married, like, we never expected something like this to happen.
Toronto Police Chief Mark Saunders confirmed today that the investigation into Faisal Hussein is complete. He would not comment on the results of the investigation. He said he would make its findings public down the road, but he wanted to speak with victims and their families first.
With respect to the investigation being over, I know that the public is interested in knowing a lot of things, and there are a lot of questions to be answered, and we will put that forward, so I don't have a concern with that, but I'm going to do it properly. The one thing that I want people to recognize is that there was loss of life, and there were a lot of people that were injured. It had a huge impact on the whole city. I have to speak with certain people that are directly involved and are victims of this. I certainly don't want their first blush of finding out what we're going to talk about to be through the screen.
The Minister of Border Security and Organized Crime Reduction, Bill Blair, is currently touring the country, gathering information on this proposed ban. Meanwhile, the families are encouraging people to sign an online petition to support the ban and asking people to talk to their members of parliament. Dwight?
Thank you, Talia. And two 18-year-old men have been arrested in the shooting murder of an aspiring sportscaster. Jonathan Gale West was killed in December. He was found shot inside a crashed car near Islington and Dixon. He was pronounced dead at the scene. Gale West was an employee of TSN working on television and radio programs there. Earlier this week, Samir Adem and Salman Ahmed were arrested and charged with second-degree murder. It's a list that thousands of Canadians are on and don't even know it. It's from a call center that uses it to scam victims by offering to help cut their credit card interest rate for free. Coming up, we go door to door to let people know they are the victims of identity theft.
Hi, are you Fernanda?
Yeah.
That's your SIN number.
Mm-hmm.
That's your credit card number.
It
could actually be used to refinance their houses, their mortgages, their cars, clean their bank accounts.
The city is promising our pothole plague is about to ease up a little.
We'll be on the road from about 4 a.m. to about 6 p.m. Tomorrow evening. You should notice a considerable difference in the state of the roadways after we complete this blitz tomorrow.
The blitz will see about 50 crews take to city streets, the Gardner and the DVP. It is expected they will fill between 4,000 and 5,000 potholes tomorrow. This is the first of what's expected to be a number of blitzes between now and April. There will still be plenty of potholes after this weekend, and new ones will form every time the temperature takes one of those wild swings we often see in winter. So what if there was a way to predict potholes before they happen? As Alicia San shows us, researchers at the University of Waterloo think they may have found one.
There's slush on the roads and it's dark. And all of a sudden, my right passenger side just gets rocked. I was still kind of shaking and the car just shut down basically and veered to the right. I obviously knew it was a pothole, but it felt bigger than that.
Every year, the city of Toronto repairs an average of 200,000 potholes. They're common this time of year given the wild freeze-thaw cycle. Water seeps into the pavement and freezes, then thaws, freezes again, weakening the asphalt until it breaks apart.
So we have people out there patrolling our roadways 24/7 during the winter months. And as they become aware of potholes, they will create a service request and we will send out crews to repair it.
They'll try to get there within 4 days of it being reported.
The way we're doing things is getting expensive and there are a lot of inefficiencies.
Every year, potholes cost taxpayers $4 to $5 million.
This type of research that we're doing at the university, we focused on the video analytics.
The University of Waterloo has been experimenting with artificial intelligence, scanning roads when they're dry.
Computing the specifications of that particular distress, whether the length, the width, the depth, things of that nature. And the decisions that are made are not reactive, they're more predictive.
Zelik thinks they can get cities to integrate this technology within the next couple of years, giving municipalities a chance to fix the problem before it starts.
It's funny, we were saying that I've become a little bit of a pothole warrior. I've reported a bunch of them. It happened really quick and I'm glad there was no cyclists and no parked cars around because I probably would have, you know, merged into their lanes.
In the meantime, there's 311. One of the top complaints to the city hotline, potholes.
Whoa. Fucking hell. Holy shit.
And we're talking about potholes being caused by that freeze-thaw cycle, and we're thawing out this weekend, I think.
You're right about that, Dwight. We're really going to be seeing kind of a seesaw with our temperatures. That certainly doesn't help things very much. I know it kind of feels mild out there today, but really the temperature is not that much, you know, a degree or so above seasonal, 1 degree out there right now. It's pleasant, though. You hear the birds singing, and that's nice. Spring's not that far off. I want to show you, though, that temperature trend we're going to be seeing as the storm system is moving in for the weekend, mostly going to affect us for the second half of the weekend. So overnight tonight, we drop to a low of -6. That's a little above seasonal. By tomorrow, into the evening hours, up to 2 degrees, but watch what happens overnight Saturday into Sunday. This is 10 a.m. Sunday, 8 degrees in the city. Yeah, we're going to be seeing some more melting going on and we'll have the concerns with flooding. But the real concern is also going to be the winds that we'll see with this system as it moves through. Once the cold front passes, the temperature's falling to -1 Sunday night and then by Monday morning down to -8. So from 8 to -8. Strong winds associated with this Sunday and Sunday overnight into Monday. So a special weather statement. Some of those winds could exceed 100 kilometers an hour, but certainly we'll see lots of gusts, 60, 70, and 80 kilometers an hour. So it is a quiet night tonight and to start the day tomorrow. That system's still back here trying to gather itself together in the Midwest. I'm going to walk you through it, walk you through the timing and the precipitation and everything coming up. Just know that tonight you can relax a little bit. No active weather, -6 tomorrow afternoon or into the evening coming up to 2 degrees, Dwight.
Thank you, Colette.
You're welcome.
There's going to be a major shutdown this weekend on the TTC. Surprise, surprise. Line 1 from St. Clair West to Union Station will be closed. This is so crews can upgrade the automatic train control signals. Shuttle buses will be running in place of the subway. You may have seen them on your way to work. Protesters were out at TTC stations across the city today. They want to make their voices heard about the province's plans to upload the subway. Linda Ward has more on why they are so concerned.
Transit public! Keep transit public!
We've already distributed tens of thousands of flyers in over 35 subway stations and the Scarborough RT stations. And we're here to say that we don't want to pay more to just get into a more crowded subway, streetcar, or bus anymore.
It means we could have more fare hikes, we could have service cuts, and it means our city won't have a say over how we want to build our city and plan our city.
And part of today's action included action on the part of those who work in the subway system, fare collectors, operators like these wearing t-shirts that say, "Keep transit public." This is the first time we've seen the people that actually work in the system take a stand on this issue. Why now?
We're community members like everybody else, and we know the importance of public transit. And public transit has been a hot topic for several years. But if the province really cared about transit, they would fund it properly.
Meanwhile, people just really trying to make their way here to work this morning. We did manage to stop a few of them to ask them how they feel about the proposed move.
I really don't have an opinion on that one, actually.
I
personally don't have anything invested into whether Toronto runs it or whether the province runs it.
I honestly, I don't know enough about it, so it's great that people are bringing it forward so that we can see more about it.
So a lot of people right now don't realize until it gets uploaded and they start paying $16 a ride or $17 a ride like the Up Express.
If Doug Ford wants to fix the TTC, he should fund it rather than steal it. And together, we're going to make sure that we stop him.
While actions like these have been met with a degree of apathy from the public, Councillor Cressy and Councillor Josh Matlow are hoping to do something to change that. Next week, they'll bring a motion forward at City Council to ask the city to implement a public awareness campaign, ads on TTC vehicles, announcements in TTC stations to try and light a fire under transit riders. Linda Ward, CBC News, Toronto.
Now, the TTC lost $61 million last year due to fare evasion. That's a lot of money for a service that is about to increase its fares for paying customers. What the TTC and riders have to say about it, coming up. If you get a phone call from someone offering to help cut your credit card interest rate for free, it could be a scam. Canada's anti-fraud unit says it receives about 300 complaints every year. But the latest marketplace investigation found there could be a lot more victims than that. A leaked list from one call center shows there have been thousands of Canadian victims. And as Magda Garbiselassie explains, the damage can be difficult to stop.
Hi, are you Fernanda?
Yeah.
We're going door to door, letting people know they're victims of identity theft.
That's your SIN number.
Mm-hmm. That's your credit card number.
They're on a list that was leaked to Marketplace. There are around 3,000 Canadians victims of a low-interest scam, and this is how it begins.
Carol, this is Ronnie in the verifications department.
You think it's a credit card company. There's an offer to reduce your interest rate for a one-time fee, but it's a scam, and it's about more than that one-time payout. It's about phishing for more information.
And the expiration date.
In Winnipeg, Grace Johnston knows firsthand what happens after the phone call.
The Royal Bank sent me, you know, a letter saying, come pick up your credit card, and I hadn't applied for one.
She says she alerted her bank. She got a new credit card and thought it was behind her, but she's on our list too.
My credit information is out there, and it keeps coming back to haunt me.
According to a former fraudster, it could keep happening. Mohammed Yousfi used to run the low-interest scam at a call center in Pakistan. He says the information he gathered,
it could actually be used to refinance their houses, their mortgages, their cars, clean their bank accounts.
How can victims fight back? Here in Canada, Equifax and TransUnion, the two credit reporting bureaus, offer some protections. But the service that Yousfi says really works is a credit freeze. It gives the consumer the power to lock down their credit with the bureaus, so fraudsters can't open new accounts.
That would actually be a huge blow to the lower interest rate credit card scammers.
Credit freezes are offered in the U.S. for free, but not in Canada.
One province, Ontario, was working on it. There was legislation that would require credit bureaus to offer this service, but it stalled after the new government came into power. The minister in charge of consumer protections now tells us he's exploring the topic. Magda Gebreselassie, CBC News, Toronto.
For more on this scam and how to protect yourself from identity theft, watch the full Marketplace investigation tonight at 8 p.m. on CBC or stream anytime with the CBC Gem.
DeMar DeRozan is getting set for what should be a very emotional night. I'm Greg Ross at Scotiabank Arena. 7 months after he was traded, the former Raptor will play his first game here in Toronto, the city he called home for the first 9 years of his career. We'll have all the details coming up after the break.
The weather update is brought to you by Train Extreme Conditions Testing. It's hard to stop a train, really hard. Train, the most reliable heating and cooling brand.
DeMar DeRozan will play his first game at Scotiabank Arena tonight since that controversial trade to the Spurs 7 months ago. Greg Ross joins us live from the game right now. Greg, it's going to be an emotional night down there. I might even shed a tear, buddy.
It absolutely is, Dwight. In fact, we're already seeing some of that emotion. There's DeRozan just walked out onto the court for his warm-up. There's a sprinkling of fans here in the stands, maybe 1,000 people that showed up early, and they gave him a standing ovation. I have to tell you, this is not your typical regular season game. There's definitely a playoff-like atmosphere here. There's lots of electricity in the air, and we're seeing playoff-like ticket prices as well. I spoke with one fan who told me he paid $700 per ticket just to be here to see DeRozan tonight, but he says it's worth it because for Raptor fans, this is their first opportunity since that trade last July to show DeRozan just how much they appreciate him. Back on the court where his NBA career began nearly a decade ago, DeMar DeRozan wasn't showing much emotion at shoot-around this morning, but he admits it'll be a lot harder to contain his feelings the closer it gets to game time.
I don't know if I'm holding in for the show. I really don't know.
In his 9 seasons as a Raptor, DeRozan became the face of the team.
Down to DeRozan season. Oh!
But most importantly, he embraced the city and the fans who loved him not only for the things he did on the court, but also his involvement in the community off of it.
He did a lot for the city. He did a lot for sick kids, too.
DeRozan spent countless hours working with charities around the city. But the thing that endeared him to Toronto fans more than anything was his desire to stay.
He was a huge impact on the city. Everyone loved him. Like, he was just a huge icon.
It's Canadian pride, right? A lot of players don't want to sign with Toronto, and the fact that you have a player that actually wanted to stay. DeRozan's the first superstar, pretty much, that wanted to stay in Toronto.
What reaction do you think he's going to get from the fans tonight?
He'll get an incredible reaction, just high-pitched.
DeRozan's former teammate and best friend, Kyle Lowry, expects fans will be on their feet.
Over under 2.5 on a standing ovation. I'm going to take the over.
DeRozan says a standing ovation would be a first for him.
I always thought that was the coolest thing in the world. Like, I never received one, you know, so if it's one of them long-standing ovations, it's like, you know, it's definitely be overwhelming.
Once the game starts, it'll be all business for Lowry and DeRozan, who will face each other for the first time in 7 years.
Right now, he's the enemy, you know what I mean? So it's time to go to work.
But I'm looking forward to playing against him. You know, I learned so much from Cal.
For fans, their allegiance will be torn tonight.
I'm hoping he scores like 40, 50 points on us. But yeah, I'm hoping he does really well.
DeRozan says, regardless of the outcome, it'll be special.
Sometimes you just want to indulge and enjoy the moment because it's a moment that will never be duplicated.
I have to say, this is maybe the most watched warm-up I've ever seen. And there's DeRozan right in front of our cameras getting set for this game tonight. Now, there were 3 other players who were involved in that trade that saw DeRozan go over to the Spurs. Jakob Poeltl, who will be in the lineup with the Spurs tonight. And for the Raptors, Danny Green and, of course, Kawhi Leonard. Now, they both made their return to San Antonio earlier this year. And for Kawhi, he got a much different response from fans in San Antonio. They booed him every time he touched the ball. Leonard said for him, it's just another regular season game. He says it doesn't make any difference to him. But for that man right there, this is going to be a very, very special night. And if it's anything like we've already seen, I think it's going to be a love-in for DeMar DeRozan, Dwight.
I think it will be. He will get that standing ovation. Well-deserved. Thank you, Greg. The Toronto Police Youth Hockey Program getting a boost today.
The idea behind the program, guys, is to get you guys active and playing a sport that we love the most. We're very prejudiced. We love hockey, but it's really about being active.
The National League Hockey League Players Association donating hockey equipment to some fortunate grade 5 students. The students are part of the Toronto Police Service Youth Hockey Program. Besides getting the equipment, they also get a chance to get jerseys signed by William Nylander and Ron Hainsey from the Leafs. This is all part of the NHLPA's Goals and Dreams Fund, which donates to hockey programs around the world.
People don't understand that, you know, we have over 20,000 cases a year in this city of people who may be watching the news right now that have no idea that they're going to become a victim.
This past year has been one of extreme traumatization in Toronto. The violence in the city has been like none other that we've experienced before.
The police chief was on hand today to present a check to Victim Services Toronto for almost $700,000. The organization provides crisis response and intervention. Every year, the chief holds a gala to raise money for Victim Services. Today's contribution was the largest yet from the gala.
Does the video contain Mr. Kraft inside receiving the alleged axe? The answer to that is yes.
Robert Kelly was indicted before a Cook County grand jury on 10 counts of aggravated criminal sexual abuse involving four victims.
Two big names in the world of sports and entertainment have been charged today. After months of allegations and detailed reports, R. Kelly is facing the music, and New England Patriots owner Robert Kraft is caught in an undercover sting at a Florida massage parlor. We'll have the very latest on both of those stories coming up. Did you hop on a streetcar and forget to pay? Or maybe you walked past an empty fare collector's booth? Or you didn't tap because the Presto machine was out of order? Well, you may have contributed to a loss of $61 million for the TTC due to fare evasion. The Auditor General released the report, breaking it down by vehicle. On buses, there were losses amounting to around $30 million, followed by the subway with around $18 million dollars and streetcars with around 12 million. However, by averaging out the number of vehicles, streetcars accounted for the lion's share of the losses. The report lists 27 recommendations to decrease fare evasion and boost passenger revenue. Those recommendations include things like an awareness campaign for riders and expanding the fare inspection program. But what else is contributing to the huge loss? Kelda Ewan joins us live from a streetcar stop at King and John. And Kelda, should we be putting all the blame on the shoulders of the passengers here?
Well, Dwight, all of the TTC passengers that I spoke with today say no. Now, it is all the streetcars I've been passing by so far, they're not extremely crowded, but it is Friday. Now, typically on any other weekday, they are quite packed. And the commuters I spoke with who have to take the streetcar during the rush hour on a weekday, they say that oftentimes it's not that they don't want to pay the fare. It's because they simply aren't able to because it's too crowded.
Celestine Nima takes the King streetcar
twice a day, every day.
She admits there are times she doesn't pay her fare, but not for lack of trying.
Because it's really packed in here, so I don't know how people, especially if you're paying by tokens, how you'd get to the machines when there's like so many people in here, so.
She's not the only one.
So do you find sometimes that you are unable to pay because you can't get up there?
Yes.
There are two token machines on each of the new streetcars. Some say even if you make it to one, the ordeal may not be over.
People will put their $3.25 in and it'll just come back out.
Andra Rostin actually uses a Presto card and has run into her share of problems too.
Sometimes the Presto machine is broken, or if you get on the back of the streetcar, that machine's broken.
They have to fix their machines.
Riders are supposed to pay their fare at the next stop if they can.
People who aren't able to pay their fare are generally well-intentioned. They'll find a way to pay their fares.
Most of those we spoke with say they don't. And while those who want to pay but can't are included among the auditor's numbers, the TTC says those passengers are not the ones they're concerned with.
You know, there's intent to pay your fare, which is very different from intent to defraud the system. So when we talk about fare evasion, what we're really talking about is people who are deliberately not paying their fare.
Like those climbing over turnstiles or using a children's Presto card.
We're hiring 70 new fare inspection staff. We've got it's in our budget proposal for this year. When we do that, that means 70 more people that we'll have available to, you know, go out into the subway system, go out onto buses, as well as streetcars.
Green says the TTC is working to make things easier so that passengers who intend to pay are able to pay the first time around.
You know, we've got a new disposable Presto card coming, which would be a single or a double-use tap. So these are things that will make the system better.
A Presto card will soon be the only way to pay. Tickets and tokens are expected to be phased out by the end of this year. Starting April 1st as well, fares will be going up by 10 cents. The TTC said that's expected to provide roughly $26 million in revenue. Well, that's less than half of the $61 million they lose out on by people not paying their fare in the first place. Dwight.
Yeah, and those people with the higher fares also need to pay too, or they're not going to get that money either. Thank you, Kelda. Yeah. A few last-minute touches before the big day. The Oscars are just around the corner. We'll break down the best bets and take you to the red carpet coming up in about 10 minutes. Just north of the Oscars red carpet, a carpet of white stuff has surprised locals and Canada. They say it's to blame. The system that dumped the white stuff into Southern California started in Alberta. Even though it's not that much snow, a highway was closed and a school district shut down yesterday. It's the first time these areas have seen snow in about 4 years. And the song says it doesn't rain in Southern California. Nobody said anything about snow, Colin.
It's possible. We know it happens, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not surprised they end up. That's what a snow day looks like for Southern California and no school for some of the kids, which is pretty incredible. But I'll tell you a little secret. I lived there for a little while, and if there was even just a bit of a sprinkle, the cars would start slamming into each other. People were not leaving enough distance or anything. So I'm not surprised what a little bit of snow will do in Southern California there. Current temperatures out there, they're a little bit mild. It does feel pretty nice. And it is going to be quiet tonight in terms of our weather pattern. So that's nice to see. There will be some cloud cover mixing in there. Then that'll really start to build up tomorrow, especially in the afternoon hours. But the storm system I'm most concerned about, and I want to share with you the breakdown of how it's going to move through, is still kind of getting itself together back here in the Midwest. It is going to tap into some of this moisture, but really that area of low pressure will be developing and then coming through as we go into the start of the day on Saturday. We're not really looking at any problems. As I say, the clouds will start to really thicken up. It's Saturday evening. This is going towards midnight, okay? We will see showers coming in. The winds will get a little stronger. The temperature will start to go up as we go into Sunday morning, coming up to about 8 degrees. And then on the backside of the system, there'll be some breaks, by the way, in between the precipitation. We could even see some sunshine in part of the day on Sunday, but there will be very, very windy conditions. These white lines I have on here, we've got the isobars on there. When you see those getting close together, that's why I wanted to show them to you. We have a really strong pressure gradient, and that's what's driving the winds between this area, low pressure going through, and high pressure just off to the east. So extremely windy conditions. We will see that colder air move in. So on the backside, there could be a bit of a mix. Even into the city, we'll likely see some flurries late day Sunday. But a special weather statement in place. Again, this is Sunday. They get stronger in the afternoon, and then overnight into Monday, some of those gusts could exceed 100 kilometers an hour. I'll show you what the forecast wind gusts look like as it comes through into Sunday morning. Some of these, Hamilton, St. Catharines, almost 80 kilometers an hour, and never mind almost, at 80 for Hamilton, Toronto at 70. This is even Sunday night, overnight still strong. As I say, into Monday morning, it'll still be breezy. These are damaging winds. These are the kind of things that can bring down tree limbs, can also bring down our power lines. So we'll be watching carefully on some of the problems we could have on Sunday. Travel delays, also an issue. Overnight tonight, those are your lows. And then tomorrow afternoon, but just keep in mind that temperature will be nearly steady into the evening. And then coming up as we go into Sunday morning, and then it'll be falling later in the day on Sunday as the cold front goes through. So all kinds of conditions coming with this system. Not a lot of precipitation, however. The winds are going to be one of the strongest problems we're going to see, Dwight.
Thank you, Colette.
You're welcome.
Prime Minister Justin Trudeau visited St. John's this morning to talk about funding university research, but he ended up answering questions about the SNC-Lavalin affair. Trudeau is fully endorsing the version of events described by Canada's top public servant. Yesterday, Michael Wernick told the Commons Justice Committee there was no inappropriate pressure on the former Attorney General, Jody Wilson-Raybould.
I want to begin by saying that the Clerk of the Privy Council, Michael Wernick, is an extraordinary public servant who has served this country and continues to serve this country under governments of different political stripes with integrity and brilliance. And he is someone who we need to heed very carefully when he chooses to express himself publicly. And I'm sure everyone is taking a careful look at his words yesterday.
And as the company makes political news, SNC-Lavalin is also reporting a $1.6 billion loss this past quarter. Finance Minister Bill Morneau was meeting with private sector economists at George Brown College today, and he was asked specifically about this news.
It really can't speak about the potential success of any individual business. I think in the case of SNC-Lavalin, it's an organization that's been very successful over a long period of time. And we obviously want to see a business like that that employs that many Canadians continue to be successful.
SNC employs 9,000 Canadians, with more than a third in the provinces of Quebec. The company has also issued profit warnings recently related to a mining project and its oil and gas business. The owner of the Super Bowl champion New England Patriots, Robert Kraft, is being charged by police after he was allegedly twice videotaped paying for sex and receiving sex at an illicit massage parlor in Florida.
That would be Mr. Robert Kraft.
Robert Kraft, the owner of the New England Patriots?
Yes, sir.
And what is he being charged with?
He's being charged with the same offenses as the others, and that is soliciting another to commit prostitution.
completely incompetent.
The 77-year-old hasn't been arrested yet. A warrant will be issued and his lawyers will be notified. The charge comes amid a widespread crackdown on sex trafficking in the area around Palm Beach County. About 200 arrest warrants have been issued recently. More are expected. Police say they planted undercover cameras in massage parlors and videotaped interactions between men and the female employees. A spokesperson for Kraft said they categorically deny he engaged in any illegal activity. Prosecutors in Chicago have charged Grammy-winning R&B singer R. Kelly with several counts of sexual abuse.
Earlier today, Robert Kelly was indicted before a Cook County grand jury on 10 counts of aggravated criminal sexual abuse involving four victims.
Allegations against Kelly surfaced in a recent documentary series about the singer called Surviving R. Kelly. If he's convicted on all counts, Kelly could face up to 70 years in prison. He has denied the accusations and is expected to make a court appearance tomorrow.
I'm Zuleika Nathu in Los Angeles on the Oscars red carpet. The Academy has made a few missteps over the last few months, but can they pull out all the stops and put on a good show? I'll have more on that coming up after the break.
Preparations are underway for the 91st Academy Awards. The Oscars take place Sunday at the Dolby Theater in Los Angeles. It marks the end of Hollywood's awards season, but it's been a tough slog for the Academy. They've had to deal with low TV ratings and controversy over who would host. Kevin Hart was originally asked, but later withdrew. And that's not the only misstep for the Oscars this year. Zuleika Nathu joins us from the red carpet in Los Angeles now to explain. So, Zuleika, run us through some of the other bad decisions the Academy has made.
I know, Dwight. Where do we start? First, the Academy was called out by SAG-AFTRA, which is the acting union here in the U.S., for apparently pressuring its stars to only appear at the Academy Awards. And SAG-AFTRA said that it was saying this based on concerns it was receiving from its own membership. Then you had the Academy trying to find ways to shorten its three-hour show, or at least keep to time. And they decided that an effective way to do that would be to edit four of the categories that are normally televised during the ceremony, including Best Live Action Short and Best Makeup and Hairstyling. Well, it wasn't until high-profile filmmakers and actors
stood up and said that they weren't okay with that decision, and they criticized it, that the Academy was forced to nix the idea. We spoke with Kyle Buchanan, who's the award season columnist in LA for the New York Times, about their efforts to try to shorten the Oscars this year.
I think that in their haste to shorten the show, they're forgetting that people like the length of the show. I mean, they do if you can fill it with good things. You know, if it's bloated and the banter isn't great and the musical numbers aren't wonderful, then sure, people might have a legitimate complaint. But if you can make that Oscar show great, then I don't think that there is a problem with how long it runs. Just worry about making it wonderful.
And that brings us to the other point, having no host. When the Academy decided to part ways with Kevin Hart because he wouldn't apologize for past homophobic comments that he had made in his stand-up years ago, they decided not to replace him. And that might not seem like a very big deal, but when you have a show that's 3 hours of programming, it's very difficult to keep an audience entertained, interested, fresh, without having someone on stage to help do that.
Yeah, you kind of need a guide to guide you through the program. So let's talk about the campaigning now for award season. How was it this year compared to last? Because it is a campaign to try to get one of these statuettes.
It is. So much happens behind the scenes, and I think people know that there can be some sort of dirty political tricks in behind the scenes, but this year is a little bit different, and that's because of Netflix being a player in all of this. I want to show you the number of Netflix billboards for Roma that are just in the span of less than 3 blocks. There's probably about 5 or 6 of them on Sunset Boulevard, high traffic area here in LA, expensive to get that space, but they want the Best Picture Oscar. And it seems that if they get it, no filmmaker will question working with Netflix because they know that they'll get a theatrical release, that they'll get proper distribution, and that they could go all the way. If Netflix wins with Roma, that will make it the first streaming service to ever win an Oscar for Best Picture. Dwight?
Wow, how things have changed since Netflix came on the scene. Enjoy the weekend down
since
there.
Since the old days, I
yes.
know.
Have fun on the red carpet, Zuleka.
Thanks.
Now, this year's hostless Academy Awards ceremony will surely be one of a kind, but still, who gets that golden statue remains the big question. Film critic Eli Glasner weighs the odds from Los Angeles.
There has never been an Oscars like this, and I'm not talking but just about the drama inside, but some of the races themselves. So let me help you out in your Oscar pool, beginning with some of the safer bets, including Rami Malek winning as Best Actor for his performance as Freddie Mercury in Bohemian Rhapsody. It's a crowded category. You got Christian Bale, Bradley Cooper, but that electric performance of Mercury is undeniable. Also undeniable is the fact that Glenn Close will win for her performance in the movie The Wife as Best Actress, a fitting tribute to her amazing career. Let's move on to Best Supporting Actor. That will be won by Mahershala Ali for his performance as Don Shirley in the movie Green Book, even though Shirley's family has complained about some of the inaccuracies of his portrayal. I think that will strike a chord with voters, which leaves us the Best Supporting Actress category, which will be won by If Beale Street Could Talk's Regina King. She is an actor, a producer, a director, has a lot of support in this organization, in the Academy, and she will take home that trophy on Sunday night. Now, some of the tougher races to call Best Director could be Alfonso Cuarón for his work with the amazing movie Roma, such a personal vision, such a testament to his skills as a director, but Spike Lee has never been nominated as a director at the Oscars, and this is a golden opportunity for his work in Black Klansman. So that is a serious threat to Cuarón, which leaves us the toughest race of all, Best Picture. What a race. You have Green Book, you have Black Panther, you have Bohemian Rhapsody, and you have Roma. Each of those movies have already won awards at other ceremonies, so it's a tough one to call, but ultimately my prediction is Roma to win at the Oscars. Good luck in your Oscar pool. Eli Glasser, CBC News, Los Angeles.
In the 70s, she helped start a program at U of T for adults from underrepresented communities who may have lacked the qualifications to get into university, get those skills and knowledge. Now, nearly 50 years later, I speak to Karen Brathwaite about the transitional program and the future of university education.
There is something about tradition in universities which I think it halts progress. You know, in these places we used to hear about the best and the brightest. Do you still hear that kind of language? We should not.
For some, getting into university is easy, but for many from marginalized communities, access to places like the University of Toronto is not a simple goal. Karen Brathwaite helped start a program at U of T in the 70s that gave students from underrepresented communities a chance to shine. I spoke to her about the history of the program and her hopes for its future. Let's start, Karen, with taking us back to 5 decades ago. What was the genesis of this program? Why did it come about?
I was approached about a discussion of a summer project on the university campus of U of T, where mature students from the Black community in one summer program could be prepared for access to the university.
Talk about 5 decades later what this program has meant, not only to the Black community, but I understand students from other communities eventually.
When TYP started at U of T, there was not a First Nations house. And if we thought that our representation was dismal, when TYP started, the representation of First Nations communities was almost zero. It was almost nil. So by the time the program was opened at U of T, it was open for Blacks or African Canadians, Aboriginal students, working class students who had no experience of university in their family.
So anybody could come that maybe needed it.
Yes, high need.
How important is access for people, especially marginalized people, to institutions like the University of Toronto, like York, like
Is this essential? For otherwise, how will they get here? And in my view, this university is a better, stronger place because of programs like TYP. I cannot remember seeing another black female professor in this institution in the early years I was here.
You're one of the only ones here.
I did not find any at OISE when I came in 1967. So there has been change in the institution, but the question is it enough?
Yes.
Is it enough?
Is it enough? I'll put that question to you.
Yes, there are many more of our students here, but we need more because these students have helped to enrich and advance the life of our community. And as you know, so many of our students are still dropping out of school, still being streamed. You know, there's a restlessness. We need more TYPs, more access programs, more opportunities for students.
You hear about money being cut that would have helped people access higher education. When you hear about government funding being taken away from programs like this, what is your reaction?
I'm distressed. And I think finances is one of the big hurdles for our students. OSAP, you've heard that word.
I used it to help pay my way through school,
yes.
And then paid it back after.
OSAP keeps our students in debt for many years after graduation. So the whole question of affordability for people who do not come from backgrounds of money and privilege, it is still a key question we should ask. How affordable is this education?
Five decades ago, you had a vision with some others in the community, and it came to fruition, and it's lasted this long. Does it surprise you, though, that still 5 decades on, that a program like this is still needed in our society?
It should surprise me, but it does not.
Really?
There is something about tradition in universities which I think it halts.
Yes.
Progress. You know, in these places, we used to hear about the best and the brightest. Do you still hear that kind of language? We should not. These are spheres of opportunity. Some of the brightest are out there in the suburbs, dropping out of schools. You know, the institutions have to reach out and get our students here. And of
pioneering soul singer Jackie Shane has died. The transgender artist built a loyal audience performing on the Yonge Street Strip back in the 60s. Shane was born in Nashville but fell in love with our city and made Toronto her home. Despite disappearing from the music scene years ago, a collection of Shane's songs called Any Other Way was just nominated for a Grammy for Best Historical Album. Jackie Shane was 78 years old. Looking forward to that warm-up this weekend so we can get some of that out of the way. So if more comes, we have somewhere to put it.
Yeah, we need that part.
But it's the wind we have to worry about.
Yeah, we don't need that part.
No.
And that's what's coming with this storm system. So there is a special weather statement from Environment Canada. And again, this is for the second half of the weekend. So this is for Sunday night into Monday. We're looking, some of those winds, they could exceed 100 kilometers an hour. Some of the wind gusts that we'll be seeing strong, sustained winds and lots of areas that are going to at least get to 80 kilometers an hour. So when we have a situation like this, Dwight, we are talking about damaging winds. Power lines are going to be fragile in this sort of a wind, and tree limbs and things like that.
So if you were like me and you had toboggans in the driveway, you might want to be careful.
You don't want them on your windshield.
They ended up in the road. And I think I also lost the barbecue cover the last time, got blown away. So we're talking about really, really strong winds here.
Maybe another one will come your way and it'll land in your yard and you'll just keep trading with your neighbors.
There you go.
Yeah, it's that kind of a storm. There is some precipitation, by the way, with it as well. So it comes in as light showers and then it'll be sort of intermittent on the backside, though we could get a bit of a mix coming back or some flurries.
Gotta be prepared this weekend. That's our show for tonight. Thank you for watching. Chris Glover has your next local news tonight at 11.